to this BET podcast. My name is Rasmus Beck, and today, next to me, the biggest star in Dutch men's singles. I think that's fair to say. Mark Kelly, welcome to you.
Welcome.
Mark, a lot of things have happened since we sat here the last time. One thing is moving to Denmark. Good results, also a good thing. How is it to be you at the moment, actually?
Yeah, what you already said, there's a lot of changing. Now moving to Denmark, that is actually a big change in my life, but I like it, and yeah, the training are good here. I can still practice with Jonas, my coach, and also Joran is in Denmark, so yeah, I think it is a good step. There are more sparring partners, as everybody know. Denmark is a bigger country in badminton sport, so it is nice actually at the moment.
Mm. Mark, maybe try to explain a bit what happened in the Netherlands, because for those who do not know, it might seem strange that why now move to Denmark and you can practice back in the Netherlands. What happened here?
I think actually now it is maybe a couple of months ago that Jonas decided actually before the European Games, he decided that he wants to go back to Denmark to go to his family, and he stays actually quite long already in the Netherlands. And then we found a solution actually till the Olympics for me, and that was to go to Denmark and to train with him, because I think when he was coming, my development is actually going really well in the right direction. And I want to practice with him. And then we start to find a solution, and the solution was okay, going to Denmark, and it was good for me because yeah, I have a relationship with Lina, so it was also nice in that way. And then we found a solution that we can stay in Denmark, practice in Denmark, and we have some good players. And actually, we have some good youth players, but still they are not there yet. And I think there are some good players where we practice now every morning, mate. So that is actually a good step.
Mm. We have also seen some funding cuts in the Netherlands. Is that also a reason behind it?
No, I don't think so. It's for sure that the Netherlands have some problems with the money and also the federation, because we are just a really small sport in the Netherlands. But I don't think that is the reason. I think the reason is especially because it's really important that I also qualify for the Olympics, and yeah. And we didn't find a coach on that short time. So then we say, okay, yeah, I have a really good relationship with Jonas. And I said like, yeah, then maybe this is a solution. And we talked together, and they still have a really good communication with Jonas and the federation. And he's still working for the federation. So I think everything is just like what it was. Only I'm now training in Denmark. That's the big difference.
Having a coach like Jonas Ludek, who we're talking about here, and actually moving because of a coach for you. Actually, normally it's the other way around, that a coach goes to a country because she wants to work with some kind of players. What does that tell you, that you actually did the opposite?
I think that it's also said that I really like the connection with two of us. And I think what we said, we have now a good setup. We're training the most of the time in Greve. And we have some good players there. And I think, yeah, he have a lot of connections. So a lot of players are coming, also club players, but also Igor, for example. So, yeah, I think we have a way better group than in the Netherlands now. We are training with maybe every morning with five or six players. We have actually a quite high level. So that's it's a way better actually at the moment for me now. But it is still, what you said, it is still... For me, it is changed. It is different because I was in the Netherlands. There's my family, my friends, my house, but now it changed to Denmark. But yeah, still it is nice now here.
There's no secret that it's also expensive to live in Denmark. Nothing is cheap in Denmark. How do you fund this? Is that due to the Dutch Federation, or do you have sponsors which are going to chip in more, or how does that work?
Actually, for me, it is nice that I can still at the same house with Lina, so then it's not really expensive. But the food and everything, it is more expensive. Yeah, I agree. But it is just I pay by myself. The federation helps me also a lot with, for sure, with Jonas, the coaching, the physios and stuff like that. But yeah, what I said before, it is just small, so we have to find our own sponsors to get some money. And sometimes that's hard, but that's how it is.
How does it feel to be that guy knocking on doors asking for money?
It is hard, actually. Yeah. And I already said also on my Instagram, actually, one time that I searching for sponsors and stuff like that. And I'm not the guy who wants to do that, but sometimes you have to do it, I think. Mm. And especially in the Netherlands, it is if you see other sports, it is, yeah, if you compare it with other sports, the big sports, it's a huge difference. And that is sometimes hard to believe that we trying to qualify for the Olympics and also the others are doing a great job. And sometimes I see like, okay, it's not really fair in my eyes that they, that some people are really struggling to play the sport, actually, badminton in the Netherlands. But yeah, sometimes you have to accept how it is.
Let's talk a bit about this Olympic race, because it has for quite some time been that the Netherlands have their own rules of qualifying. It's not enough just to be qualified. You also have to be honorable participant, I think we can call it. How does it feel as one of the players knowing that you can actually make it, but not being allowed to go?
In the beginning, I was a little bit like, yeah, it's really tough and it's really hard. But actually, I can understand it now. And it feels more an honor to be there and represent the Netherlands if I qualify for the Olympics. Because, yeah, I think, and it's not hard to say to the others, not at that, but the Netherlands won't want to say send tourists actually to the Olympics. And I can totally understand that. And I think it is also fair enough that to say like you have to also reach something to qualify for the Olympics. And for sure, it is really hard in the sport, especially for a European guy in a, just a small country to qualify in a top 20 of the world. And then I can go to the Olympics. But I think it's fair enough to say, and I want to fight for it. And if I make it, it's, yeah, then it feels even more nice that I be there and represent the Netherlands and with those rules, actually.
But Margit, I'm punching you, but it's also easy for you to say, because right now it actually looks like you're going.
Yeah.
What if you are two spots short? Would you still feel it's fair?
I don't know. But I think what I said before, and everybody knows in the Netherlands, it is not only for the badminton, but every sport have really hard rules. So we know that. And it is not if you're not reaching it, if you're 21, for example. Yeah, I think then I'm sometimes sleeping in my bed and like, okay, shit, there is not the rules, but for the BBF or some was not there. But yeah, still, I think, yeah, I know the rules. And then I have to do better next time. And that's fair enough to say. And yeah, now I'm really going for it, and I think I'm standing okay for it now.
And just to be clear, what are the rules for you, for those who do not know? I know, but yeah, please enlighten me.
I have to stand in a clean list in the top 20 of the world. Yeah, so I'm standing now okay, I think, for it. Yeah.
Yeah. Meaning that the clean list is if you take out the players, for instance, if you have 5 Chinese, it doesn't count.
No.
But it's the actual people going.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm now standing around number 30 in the world, or 35.
Yeah.
So if I can hold that spot, then I think it's okay, and then I can go. But I cannot drop
17
I cannot drop down really much, because then other players were coming. But it's exactly what you said. Yeah.
Mark, previously we have seen you deliver good results, also winning tournaments. But I think it's fair to say when I watch you, for instance, that I have so big expectations because I know what you can do. But sometimes I'm also getting disappointed because it can be hard for you to actually put it together in the same tournament. Am I fair, or how do you see it when I say this?
No, I feel the same, actually. I also sometimes quite disappointed by myself because I know the level is sometimes there, and I know I think I can beat some really good players and some top players, maybe not the best in the world, but close to the best. And then sometimes when I also play some other tournaments, then it is really like, okay, what is happening? And I think that is also what me and Jonas really working on, to be more consistent in all the tournaments. And maybe I don't want to say it is a focus thing, but maybe it's also a mental thing, and to prepare every match the same like the big tournaments here. And I've been a tough period, actually. The start of the qualification year was actually quite hard for me. But the last couple of months are going well. A little bit injury in Belgium, but it's going now better. So yeah, it is going the right direction. But still, I can totally understand what you're saying, and I'm also struggling with that. But yeah, I'm working on it every day.
What does it tell you that, because your start of your qualification, now you say it was hard, I would actually say it was not that good.
No.
What does it tell you that you actually managed to turn it around?
I think it also, I'm really also talking with my mental coach about it and stuff like that, because actually the start of the qualification was actually not that good. Mm-hmm. I lost some challenge and semifinals and hard losses actually. But I think it's also confidence, and if you get a win, a really good win, then you get a really get a boost, I think. Mm. And yeah, then you feel like, okay, you can still do it, you're still improving, and at the training it goes really well. But everybody, every athlete has that sometimes. I think the training goes well, you feeling good, you're in good shape, but if you go on court, you don't feel that, man. You don't feel it, and it's not coming out in a match. But I think I just believe in myself, and I know, it's always like this in your career, and it's also in a year like that. So I just believe and work really hard to get that result, but that give me a boost. And I don't know which result it was, but I think when you see my matches, I think I didn't play that bad actually, but I just missed maybe 10% of winning all those matches. Yeah,
I don't think there's a lot of people doubting that you can win a Super 100 or Super 300. How far are you, in your opinion, for instance, winning a Super 500?
I think still far away. I really believe that I can do it. But yeah, just to what you already said, sometimes I play some really good matches in a couple of first rounds, and then I can drop down a little bit. And that's also in my game, actually. So I can play 5 points really good, and then I drop down, and you cannot afford that to the top players. Mm-hmm. And those top players are there at the top five in a Super 500 or stuff like that. So I have to improve that. But I think I also show that I have a level to reach that.
Since you're aware of that, you have these down periods and the ups as well. Is that something that makes you nervous? We are recording this during the Denmark Open. You won a good match in the first round. Are you a bit nervous about what's happening in the second round? Or is there something that you actually don't focus on?
I'm not really focusing on that. But I know it is there, but I'm now really also enjoy my victory of yesterday, but also be aware and be really focused on what is going tomorrow. And that's the same what I'm going to do next week and the week after. There's a lot of tournaments, and especially for us European guys, you're traveling now. Yeah, crazy.
Too much.
Yeah, I totally agree that it is too much, but you have to do it if you want to qualify. And then you can also see that you're a little bit tournament tired, I think you can say that. So you have to be also focused on that. And you know that it sometimes happens in tournament that you go a little bit down or you're a little bit off.
It's not unusual that you see in an Olympic qualification period players traveling the world 54 weeks in a year, because that's basically what you do. It's crazy traveling. And then you see the players going to the Olympics, not performing at all because they're simply too tired. What are you doing to avoid that? You actually qualify for Tokyo, but you just burn out.
Actually, I talk a lot also with Jakob. He's still training in a national team. He knows what he was there actually, and also with Selena. So we have some players who have experience with that, and also our staff is actually really aware of that, because they also saw that Selena and Jakob also after Olympics get injuries and stuff like that, and maybe a burnout. Now, maybe that's a big word to say, but what you said, there was so much traveling, and I also see it now. Sometimes I am tired, even that I don't know, but still the traveling sometimes to Netherlands, to Denmark, it's cost a lot of energy. But I talk really much, and also the staff is aware, also my coaches, so the communication is really well. And so sometimes we also decide not to go Asia. And just train in Denmark. For example, I won't play the Asia trip that is coming, just to stay a little bit on my home soil and to train hard. And I think you need that. Otherwise, you get what you said. Just you cannot play your best in the Olympics.
Olympics is a championship. World Championship is a championship. European Championships and European Games is the same. Winning a European medal, what would that mean to you?
Actually, a lot. Yeah, I think. Because I didn't want any. Also this year I lost in the quarterfinal. That was actually a really hard loss. Maybe one of my hardest, I can say that. But
why?
I think there's also a lot of pressure. And actually, when I was a child, you always dream about European medals, standing on the stage there, perform, to play your best level at that tournament. And yeah, and if you don't reach that and you have a goal, and that is, yeah, that feels really hard. And in that moment, it was a really tough loss. Mm. And my confidence level was actually also dropped down really much. Yeah, the only thing what you can do is work hard and, yeah, to train. And also, yeah, say to yourself honest, like, okay, where was it wrong? Where my mistakes, mm. maybe the coach's mistake, but talk with a lot of people who have knowledge mm. about it. And I think that is... Yeah, that is what you only can do about it.
What kind of mistakes did you find in at the European Games?
I think I have a really good preparation. We have a good talk with also my coaches. The staff was everything. So good. So I think everything was right at the moment. I was in really good shape. But still, I didn't make it. Actually, I don't want to talk about it. But I don't mm. want to think too much about it mm. because it still hurts, I think, a little bit. Mm. Yeah, mistake. I think I play against also a good player, Silberman, and I think he played really good.
Maybe at the best moment. Match he's ever played.
Yeah, exactly. So fair enough to say also he played a good match. Mm. And I think I didn't play that well. Mm. And I also lost already before in Brazil. But now I prepare way better. But I still think what we said already before, I dropped down in my level. I think I was leading maybe in the third game still. Mm. And then I dropped 6 points away. And then he goes all in. And he did a good job. And I have no answer on that. Yeah.
So it's fair to say that it was a better man winning that day if you look at it now?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, yeah. I didn't play, I have to be also honest, I didn't play my top level at that moment. But he played also good. Yeah. Mm.
In April 2020, European Championships once again, this time in Kyiv, Ukraine. How do you see your chances getting that medal this time?
I think the same as this year at the European Games. Hopefully, I can get again a seeded spot. But if it goes like this, then I get my seeded spot, I think. And then we have to see it from there. But yeah, I think there's still a big chance, and I also cannot walk away from that. I think I cannot say, okay, we have to see it round by round. If I'm seeded and seeing my results in this year and also last year, yeah, I think and I believe also that I can get that medal and I can reach that medal. So I'm not walking away from that. So I see it quite big. Yeah.
So no excuse taking one match at the time anymore?
No. And that was actually also not at the European Games. No. But yeah. Yeah, but I also said fair enough, he was good at that mm-hmm. moment.
If we look at the men's singles category in Europe at the moment, of course, the guy like him, he's for sure for one to beat for you. Anders is there, Brice did well at the Europeans, European Games. We also saw Raoul Most and Silverman popping up and some player pop-ups once in a while. How do you see the level in European men's singles currently?
I think especially the Danes also with Anders. He did an amazing job at the Worlds and huge respect for that actually because yeah they still Denmark is always yeah getting a world class player still Victor is there but also all the others from the Denmark are still really strong and what you say I think also we have some young stars in Denmark in France actually are coming also Popov I think he did a great job as
good
well
job by Christo,
so. Yeah exactly yeah. So I think there are coming a lot of good young players. And also, I think also Joran from the Netherlands, he's also a little bit struggling sometimes with his level. But I still think the level is going really good in Europe. I think we have good players. And you can still see the old ones like Jano and Vitinos. But also maybe all the others from Moose is still there. And he performs still good in some tournaments. It's maybe not always. But yeah, what you said, he can sometimes... They be there out of nowhere. So I think, yeah.
Do you feel that you're getting closer to, for instance, the Danes?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think my level is going the right direction. Mm-hmm. I didn't play that. I don't play that much, actually. Mm-hmm. I don't draw them that much in tournaments. Mm-hmm. But I still think sometimes when I play them, I think... In the beginning, when I just started, I was really like, oh, what is going on here? They smoke my ass. But now I really think, yeah, I cannot beat them, not all the time, but I can beat them maybe once. If I'm in a good day and maybe they have a little bit of a bad day, then I can beat them. So, yeah, that feels also good. Yeah.
but it's actually the same thing what we started talking about. You need to find the consistency to do it one again.
Yeah.
If you want to win a European medal, we saw Radziusev do it. What does that tell you? That actually one of the guy, non-Danish guy, who actually pulled it off, and that's not long ago.
No, that's true. And I think that is also really nice for the other countries that you can see now. There is also other guys who did that and get the gold medal, actually. Mm. So, yeah, I think we also have to believe, and everybody have to believe that you can also beat those guys. If you are not believing, then, yeah, you never win against those guys. And I really also believe that I can beat them. So that is actually a good thing, yeah. Mm.
Mark, this is recorded in the early autumn 2019. If we look to the close future, to the near future, what are the short-term goals of yours?
Yeah, for sure, qualified for the Olympics. Mm. But I also think, and that's what I also talk with my coaches, I also have to care of my development this year because we are traveling so much. Mm. Yeah, you can also see that sometimes if we are not training that much, you're just your level is still standing, and I don't want that. So I'm also still really focusing on my development in that way. And for sure, I'm going to play also France next week and also Saarlouis. So yeah, and also some challenges. So I still want to win some tournaments as well, actually.
Why is it important for you? Because you are, in Demogorgon, you're playing 750, same in France. Saarlouis, I think that's a Super 100.
Yeah.
Yes, maybe Super 300, correct?
No, 100. Yeah.
Why is it important for you to take that step down, also playing on the European circuit?
I think sometimes it's also a little bit with your confidence. It is nice to play some more matches in the tournament. We all know for sure the Super 1000 and Super 750 are really strong. And if you have a bad draw, you can also draw, for example, two times from Malta or something like that. And then traveling to Asia and only play two matches, and that is sometimes hard. And I still do it, but we choose also to play some lower tournaments also to get more matches, to play also the European guys. And yeah, I think that is also a good step to, yeah, you can still train hard, you can still train in Denmark, you don't have to travel that much. And I think sometimes you need to win some matches perform well. Mm.
You won a challenge this year, as far as I recall, and does it give you confidence, or is it just like, yes, that's something I just had to do because I was top seed and I was the better one?
Actually, a little bit of both, I think, because when you win it, you also think like, okay, I was top seeded, you have to do the job, but I think it gives you also maybe a little bit behind your. In your head, like, it gives you some confidence, because winning a tournament, holding your first prize or what it is, it is give confidence. If it is a tournament where one in Ukraine or in Belgium, it doesn't matter. I think if somebody wins the tournament, that gives confidence. And it doesn't matter if it actually may be a local tournament or an international tournament, it gives confidence, I think.
That's the short-term goals. Of course, there are also big dreams. I think that I speak for all players. They want to be number one in the world. They want to play the Olympics, they want to win the Olympics, World Championships, so on. If we look realistically, what is that big dream of yours that you actually believe that you can achieve?
My big goal is actually to stand just always in the top 20, top 15 in the world. Mm-hmm. Now I'm a little bit sometimes struggling also. Can I go to the Super 1000 tournament because I'm standing on the line, actually. Exactly. Yeah. So, but I'm just want to be, just for 1 year constantly in the top 15 in the world. A spot like that will be nice. And if you want to reach that, you have to perform actually good on the tournaments and you have to achieve or winning tournaments. Yeah.
So if we sit 10 years from now and you are retired, or 15, or whenever you choose to retire,
and
you did not get that European medal, you did not get that World Championship medal, but you were 15 in the world throughout your full career, would you be happy then?
That's a good question. I don't know yet, but I think I will be happy, because I know, and everybody knows, I think if you reach the top 15 1 year in a world, then you perform well, and then you have some good, really good results. But I still want to get a European medal for sure, and I still want to go to the Olympics. So that is also really big goals. But if you don't reach that, yeah, I still think I can, if I reach the top 15 one year, then I think, yeah, I can still be happy about my career, yeah.
Mm. But it's still funny to be you also if you're not top 15.
I think so, yeah. I have a good laugh.
Perfect, Mark. Mark, thanks for stopping by. Always a pleasure. Go follow Mark on his social media. Look at what he's posting. He's actually not that bad. He's also doing some fun stuff once in a while. So, and thank you for watching the podcast, Mark. Thank you for coming.
Yeah, thanks.